Ladies and gentlemen, welcome and thank you all for being here on this day. From the family, Wilson and Heather, Graham and Fiona, and all of the family, thank you for all your love and your support, your cards. We're here for Murray Haddo, a family man and a good friend to many, to remember him and to say goodbye. My name is Anna McKessock, and I met Murray over 7 years ago. Murray and my father both served in the Royal Navy during World War II in the Russian convoys, and I set up the Russian Convoys Club, and Murray was a great supporter of it. He was a mentor, he always gave guidance, full of ideas. He was always so supportive, and of me personally, and our family. And I know he was such a supportive friend to so many other people. James Murray Haddo, known as Murray, he was born on the 24th of September, 1925, at Bute Mans, near Castle Douglas, and he came from a remarkable family. His father, who he was named after, was the Reverend James Murray Haddo, and he was a minister, and also a very well-known conjurer, who performed in charity shows dressed in his kilt across Scotland. His mother, Margaret Elizabeth Haddo, known as Etta, had actually been a professional opera singer before she settled down and they had a family together. And Murray was the third son of James and Etta. And with his two older brothers, Gillis and Sandy, he grew up in a very happy, loving home. Murray attended a few schools, a very small one, a one-teacher school at Bute Castle, then Douglas Primary School and Hutchison's Grammar in Glasgow. And he never thought of himself as a great academic, but later after the war, he won a place at Glasgow University. In fact, when he left Castle Douglas at the age of 11, the headmaster wrote in his report, he had an indefinable quality which would get him to the top of whatever he chose to do, if he wanted to. And that always amused Murray. His life and his career were full of achievements, both professional and personal. At the age of 27, he was the youngest person ever to hold the post of children's officer in social care. And he gained rapid promotions, but he always knew what he wanted to do. And in his social care career, he preferred to be working with children and families, and his drive was to make their lives better. His love, talent, and ability at sports were also remarkable. All his life, he loved sports. And not only was he awarded his cricket cap, he was outstanding at rugby. He scored 46 points in a match at Hutchinson and was named the finest kicker they'd ever seen. It's a record that possibly still stands. He was even approached by an American football talent scout. He was so good. When the boys, Gillis, Sandy and Murray, were in their teens, their father passed away from meningitis. He was only 49. He'd been working in the Gorbals with his parishioners. It was a blow to the family. In 1943, World War II was in its fourth year, and after leaving school, Murray was conscripted into the Royal Navy as a ship's writer. And even then, he managed to keep playing rugby for quite a while, representing the Royal Navy. And at his very first match, he amazed everybody by kicking a drop goal from the halfway line. And by this time, the Royal Navy were escorting merchant navy ships to and from North Russia. And Murray was drafted to the brand new destroyer, HMS Caprice. Now, the Russian convoys were incredibly dangerous and hard. The fleets had to get from Scotland to Murmansk or Archangel and back through the Arctic Circle. There were heavy mountainous seas, storms that could bend the very metal structure of the ships, snow and ice that could topple the ships. It was very, very icy cold and dangerous. And it wasn't just the weather that could kill. There were German U-boats, ships and aircraft were also out there. The U-boat wolf packs were excellent at taking out ships. And at the Kola Inlet, there was a small channel the ships had to pass through. They were notorious for watching unseen and waiting for the Allied ships to pass. Very easy targets. In fact, Murray told me once, he was on his ship and it switched with the ship behind it. Because the ship behind it went in front of them, it got torpedoed. He always said, lucky escape. Yet Murray always never said very much about the dangers. You just got on with what you had to do, and he always enjoyed his shore leave when he could go with his mates and have a few beers. They were young men, they were only 18 years old. Surviving six convoys, Murray didn't really think much about it in the years that followed. And it wasn't until 2013 the British government decided to award the Arctic Star to the men of the convoys. Murray travelled to Lochhue for a reunion of 40 veterans and to receive his medal. It was a wonderful weekend full of laughter, some tears, sing songs in the hotel, and men talking together about their experiences and meeting each other. The Russian government had always acknowledged the veterans. They'd issued a series of commemorative medals over the years, and they also awarded the very prestigious Yushakov Medal to veterans across the world. It's a stunning blue and silver medal, and all the veterans that received it were so incredibly happy and proud. Murray received his personally in 2013 from Andrei Pritsipov, the General Consul of the Russian Embassy in Edinburgh. Murray, all his life, was never afraid of change or trying new things. After the war, he went off to California, staying in Long Beach, then San Francisco, and after a few months, he decided to go to New York, where he arrived with no money, no job, and nowhere to stay. But being Murray, he soon got himself two jobs, very long hours, 6 days a week, and a few months later, he had enough money to get himself on a ship back to the UK. His main reason for coming back home was a lady named Jean Wilson, who he'd met before going to America. They kept in touch, and their romance blossomed. They got engaged in 1949, and after Murray had completed his social care course at Glasgow University, he got his first job in Wolverhampton. Jean and Murray married in 1951 and made their home there. Their first son, Wilson, was born in 1952. Then son Graham completed their family 3 years later. Jean was a home economics teacher, and Murray and Jean ran the Muir Children's Home, with over 100 children aged 5 to 16 who had very deprived backgrounds, and some had very serious behavioural problems. They ran it not as an institution, but in a way that gave these children some say in how the houses were run. They wanted them to be independent and to express themselves, and they did everything they could to improve their lives. Coming home to Scotland, they made their home in the Highlands, and bringing up their boys with a full social life, they had very many happy years together. They took the boys fly fishing for brown trout and became fully involved in the supporting Ross County Football Club. Murray took part in organising events, dances, social events. He was very active and became a director and chairperson. He was an honorary director of so many clubs, and no matter where they went, Murray always had season tickets for the local club. He also loved animals, dogs. He bred and owned boxer dogs all his life. When Murray retired at the relatively young age of 58, Murray and Jean moved back to Largs, a town they loved. They travelled all over Europe in their caravan, across the UK, France, Spain. They followed the British Golf Open Championship everywhere. They cruised on the QE2 and the Canberra, and they had a very happy life together. In 1989, Jean was diagnosed with cancer. When she passed away that year, Murray was devastated. They'd been together for 40 years, and as he said himself, the bottom had fallen out of his world. A couple of years later, Murray's world got a little bit brighter again when he met and fell in love. Jean Caldwell and he met through mutual friends, and they quickly formed a close friendship. They married in August 1991 when all the family were together. They had a bit of a sense of humour, and when they were off on a honeymoon to Dunoon, they were wearing T-shirts with the words, "We are enjoying spending our children's inheritance," on them. And Jean and Murray were very involved with the Largs Bowling Club and again took part in bowling and all the social events too. He was also past president and honorary president just in recent years. When Jean passed away about 4 years ago, Murray decided to move to Dundee. He got himself a lovely flat in Monifieth, and he was very close to Graham and Fiona, who would often visit him. He made good friends there. His friend Jimbo had a car, and the pair of them would often go out for trips in the car. He thoroughly enjoyed these trips, and Murray and Jimbo called their trips their manoeuvres. At the age of 81, Murray learned how to use a computer. He had an Alexa, and he'd play his favourite songs. When COVID struck last year and we all had to stay home, he would meet his family online via Skype or Zoom, and he often told me how lovely it was to meet all his relatives in America by Zoom. He took part in the Russian Convoys Club Zoom chats too, and just last November, he was delighted to talk to people in Archangel, Spain, England and Scotland about his experiences and to chat to fellow veterans. There's also an amazing story which came to light just recently. In the 1960s, Murray's social care career and his love of sports came together. Based in Dingwall as a children's officer, Murray had arranged an adoption for a baby girl. She was just a few weeks old. He carefully chose her adoptive parents, and he and Jean, his first Jean, had picked the baby up to take her to Inverness Airport, where her new parents were flying in from Stornoway to meet their new baby daughter and to take her home. But there was fog and the flight got cancelled. So Murray and Jean, who were on their way to watch Inverness Caledonian play Ross County at Telford Street Park, took the baby to the game. She probably became the youngest person ever to sit in the director's box watching a game. Murray often wondered what had happened to that baby. And recently Graham got in touch with the Stornoway Gazette. An article appeared on the front page asking, "Were you that baby?" The baby's uncle saw the story and said to her, "This is you." The baby, Angela, was found. Murray and Angela got in touch with each other through video chat, and he was so pleased to know she'd had a very happy childhood and life. Angela now calls him her honorary granddad, and he was so pleased to have found her, and he felt a great sense of achievement from his earlier career. My two genes. He always used to say that. And he always felt so lucky to have had his two genes. His first gene, together for nearly 40 years, and his second gene, together for 25 years. He was especially proud of his family, his son Wilson, daughter-in-law Heather, and their children, Erica, Neil, Gary, and his son Graham, daughter-in-law Fiona, and their children, Stuart and Jamie, and all his great-grandchildren, Mackenzie, Andrew, Callum, Finn, Ewan, and his wee Murray. He was an amazing man. He was sharp, witty, much to the point. He said what he felt. He was opinionated and outspoken, and he wasn't afraid to speak out to help people, even if it ruffled a few feathers. He always used to say, "You have to have a project in life." His granddaughter, Erica, wrote this in a school assignment a few years ago. "Showing an interest in everyone, Grandpa always looks for the best in people. He loves a good joke, and it's bright and breezy all the time. He's a caring, loving, fun, and a very cool guy." And that was Murray, really, a very amazing, kind, supportive, and most definitely a very cool guy. I'm now going to ask Stuart to come up, as he'd like to say a few words about his granddad.
I was hesitant to do this today, not because of the obvious emotional side to things, but also because I wanted to do a good job. And everything that I do in my life, I want to do to the best of my abilities, and I think that's something that I've inherited from Grandpa. What I didn't want to do today was maybe talk about individual moments and stories. Instead, I wanted to represent the grandchildren. And of course, directly, that's me and Jamie, Neil, Erica and Gary. But I think seeing some others who are here today, I want to take the moment to reflect on the fact that all of the Haddo grandchildren have had the honour and privilege of being surrounded by the most astonishing set of grandparents. The Haddos are an amazing group, and we've learnt so much from not just our own grandparents, but the grandparents of our cousins, distant cousins. And it was always a pleasure going to all the big Haddo events and speaking to all the older folk and learning so much from them. Every August, I meet 30 new 12-year-olds. They come into Morgan Academy in Dundee, and I become their guidance teacher. And they join 120 others who sit alongside my name. And it's my job to be there for them and there for their families. And every August I try and get them to do one thing, and I get them to try and reflect every August on what kind of person they want to be, the kind of values that they have, and also more importantly, could they name and talk about someone who inspires them? And of course, when you mention that to teenagers, it's quite often media stars and athletes and musicians, and rightly so. And every so often, not because they're very interested in what their teacher has to say or do, one or two ask me, and my answer is always unflappable and the same, and it's Grandpa. He is my inspiration, and he is the inspiration for all of the grandchildren. And I think, reflecting on some of the things that have just been said, I could stand here all day and talk about the values and the ethos that he has given all of us, but I just want to mention one or two that I try to build into my own life, and I know that all the other grandchildren do as well. That desire for self-improvement, for always keeping busy, for always taking on new projects, a lifelong learning new skills and learning new things right up until the end. I just wish that I have that energy and that ability to do that all the way through my life. He has an amazing ability to have that interest in others that has just been mentioned, and it's a genuine interest in others. It didn't matter if you were the taxi driver or his new dentist or a new neighbour or someone that he'd known for years. It was a constant stream of questions, and not questions out of just paying lip service, because he would remember everything that you said and he would give you stories connected to what you'd said. But he would also do his homework. If he was meeting somebody for the first time that he knew was going to become part of his life, he would do a bit of digging beforehand, because he wanted to form that bond. So, for example, when I took Sarah to see Grandpa for the first time, Grandpa would quite often utter the phrase, "Now, Sarah, tell me, where exactly in Newton Mearns stay Mum and Dad stay?" And then follow up with a story of him being a child and being on that road, or they always had that connection. And again, it was a genuineness, and he maintained that right up until the last few days, even. And when Sarah and I went to see him in hospital, he was still asking Sarah about her new job and still asking me about my job, and it was a genuineness that remained. He dedicated his life to caring for other people, and it's astonishing the amount of people that he has helped, both professionally and personally. And I just think that it's an attribute, again, that is passed down and has been filtered down through all of the grandparents within the Haddows. And it's something that, certainly, obviously, in my job, I've committed to doing for the rest of my life. But even if it isn't in a professional capacity, the Haddows love people and love looking after people and finding out about people. And we do that constantly. But the one thing that I think has always run through my life has been the fact that Grandpa always knew the difference between right and wrong, and always spoke out, as has just been mentioned, always acted upon things that he felt were unjust. But I must admit, there was a little bit of intimidation there when I was a lot younger, because letting down my mum and dad was one thing, but any time you let down Grandpa, that was on a whole other level. And quite often I would make mistakes and try not to tell my mum and dad, because I knew it would get back to Grandpa, and Grandpa would call me and we would speak, and it would be, again, one of his little phrases, "Now, Stuart, your dad was telling me." That was a horrible feeling. And so, actually, I learned a few years ago that one thing that would always keep me right in life is, any time I did have a decision to make, whether, again, being professionally or personally, I would always just sit back and think, well, what would Grandpa want me to do? And I'm going to maintain that for the rest of my life, because I know that he always ended up on the right side, and whatever Grandpa wants me to do, that's what I'll do, because he made decisions throughout his life that maybe impacted him, but he knew it was best for his family. And I think that's something that can't be taken away. Obviously, Sarah and I have had the joy of bringing our own wee Murray into the world and seeing him spend time with Grandpa over the past 3.5 years. And we all got to see a different side of Grandpa. Anytime he saw any of the great-grandchildren, whether it was Murray or any of the great-grandchildren that he met on Zoom or visited from America, we saw, again, a kind of a youthful, carefree, energetic Grandpa who would shower his great-grandchildren in toys and snacks. Although, I think wee Murray, I've seen more snacks in the last few weeks than I ever did when I was that age, so I don't know what has happened, but their relationship was built on just that innocence and that happiness and joy. And I think in some ways I'm quite blessed with the fact that certainly wee Murray, and I think the other great-grandchildren would be in the same, that they don't have to maybe deal with the emotional and processing involved in this, and they can just remember that really nice old man that used to just help them and be nice and be happy. And actually what made it a little bit easier for Sarah and I on the day that Grandpa passed was that we had to pick Murray up from nursery and explain to him what had happened. And Murray knew he was in hospital. His great-grandpa was in hospital, or the doctor's castle, as he used to call it. And we, Murray, knew that Grandpa was unwell. But we sat in the car and I said, look, Murray, you can't go and see Grandpa anymore. And you can't go and see him in his flat anymore. And he just looked at us and went, oh, that's sad. And then he paused for a second and looked at us again and went, but what's going to happen to all my ice lollies? And I thought that that kind of helped, because we've had that experience of seeing Grandpa have a new lease on life in the last few years with all of his great-grandchildren, and it's been some of the best years of my life seeing that. So, as I said, I could have focused on lots of individual moments and stories from my life, but they all form part of one big story, and that is the story of an astonishing man who has held us all up into the highest of standards. And I aim to do that in my own life, with the young people that I work with my family, with my friends. Those values inspire me. As I said at the start, he is my inspiration and he's all of our inspiration. And I just hope that me and Jamie, Neil, Erica and Gary, and all of the extended partners and great-grandchildren can continue to make Grandpa proud. And if any of you are really struggling at any point, as will I throughout the rest of my life, if you just ask yourself, what would Grandpa want me to do? I think everything will be okay.
Well, we're just going to take a moment of reflection. You can remain seated if you wish, and in your own thoughts and your own way, please say your final farewell to Murray. Thank you.
To light.
it's actually such a beautiful song. I now have a reading chosen by the family. You can shed tears that he is gone, or you can smile because he lived. You can close your eyes and pray he'll come back, or you can open your eyes and see all he's left. Your heart can be empty because you can't see him, or you can be full of the love that you shared. You can turn your back on tomorrow and live yesterday, or you can be happy for tomorrow because of yesterday. You can remember him and only that he's gone, or you can cherish his memory and let it live on. You can cry and close your mind, be empty and turn your back, or you can do what he'd want, smile, open your eyes, love and go on. Well, once again, thank you all for being here today. Murray's certainly left quite a legacy behind, and not just in his family, but in everybody that he's touched. On behalf of Wilson, Heather, Graham, Fiona and all the family, please go along for a wee purvey. They're all very welcome at the Landmark Hotel, which is at the end of the Kingsway. I just called it a purvey and Graham and Fiona went, what was that? A cup of tea or something a bit stronger. And when you go there, please do go there, share all your memories and your stories and raise a glass, not just a cup of tea, maybe something a wee bit stronger. Raise a glass to Murray and remember him with love and laughter, because that's what he would have wanted. We're just going to close the ceremony now with a very special piece of music, also chosen again, a favourite of Murray's by the family. Thank you.
Find the path.